Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Christine Sussman, Hellfire, by John Ellsworth, narrated by Cathi. 1. The target was Aram el-Assad, the ISIS oil czar. The place was Syria, a country gripped in a civil war and overrun by terrorists who called themselves Islamic State of Iraq and al-Sham. ISIS. Riding lazy thermals at 20,000 feet, the Predator drone had followed Aram el-Assad to a stone house in Deir Zor, eastern Syria. The purpose of the oil czar's trip from Damascus to Deir Zor was unknown to the U.S. The U.S. authorities believed his movement had something to do with the sale of crude oil, so they followed him. Blackguard demanded no less. The people al-Assad was meeting inside the stone house were likewise unknown to the U.S. What was known was that the drone operator in Reno, Nevada, claimed a high-value target in Aram el-Assad. The high-value designation came from Blackguard. Blackguard wanted an immediate missile strike. The drone pilot was ready to pull the trigger, but he lacked green authorization, so he keyed his data into Big Sister and waited. 5 minutes later, he received the call on his headset. "You are green to go, Black Cat. Repeat, green to go." The drone pilot launched one Hellfire missile. As the missile tore free of the rails, a new optical tracking image flashed on his flat screen. Estimated close to target was less than 4 seconds. The targeted stone house was a large two-story. Gathered inside were Sevi al-Assad, who was the sister of Aram el-Assad, the target, their grandmother, who owned the house, their parents, and their extended family. Sevi was marrying Mohammed al-Mari that evening. A wedding feast was cooking and long tables were made ready for the 30 wedding guests. Under roof was also the groom's entire family. Then there were additional friends and business acquaintances, and one low-level cabinet member from the Deir Zor governorate, whose job was water quality control for the Muslim community of 211,857. As custom dictated, the bride and her entourage prepared on the second floor of the house, while the groom and his fellows prepared on the first. Neither bride nor groom had seen the other for 24 hours now. Sevi, the bride, was elated when her brother Aram arrived midday. They hadn't seen each other in a year, as he was the ISIS oil minister and was always traveling on business. Neither had any idea he was an eyes-on target of the U.S. military, nor should they have. While he worked with ISIS oil planning, he preferred to think his role was discreet and his identity was unknown to the outside world. Sevi had no ISIS zealotry running in her blood, and while she didn't relate to her brother's motives and methods, all those differences were shed at the door. This was a glorious time of 5,000-year-old ritual and feasting, and today's problems were left outside in the dust. Because Aram was not part of the wedding party, he was allowed upstairs to visit his sister. They embraced and she cried, her cheek on his chest. He patted her and reassured her all was well and that he was always with her. The fight, he assured her, was going well and he was safe. Then they sat on the bed in her private bedroom and held hands and talked. She updated him on their father's business venture. Father had recently taken over a plant that manufactured automobile tires. She emphasized that father missed having his son assist him in the business. Aram studied the colorful bedspread and sadly shook his head.
"I cannot," he said. "There is Syrian oil to sell, and I am needed."
"Where will you sell it?"
"To the Chinese."
"Not to the Americans?"
"Never to the Americans."
"But is that safe? What if the Americans learn that Syrian oil is destined for the Chinese?"
"As Allah instructs, Muslim people are to prosper. The Chinese will pay double what the Americans are willing to pay."
"So that makes it an easy decision for you."
"Exactly."
As Sevi and Aram talked,
The hurried preparation of female children continued within the next two bedrooms on the same floor. Hair was being combed out and fashioned into party coiffures. Light blush was allowed for girls over 10, and perfumes misted the air as fragrances were tested on thin young wrists. One floor beneath the junior girls' preparation, the boys were having their rust knocked off. Baths were made ready, all orifices scrubbed and inspected by fathers made wary by the boys' antipathy towards soap and predilection for wrestling in the sandy soil outside. Luxurious clothes unpacked the day before and hung around the walls to lessen wrinkling were now sorted and donned as males of all ages were made ready. Sevi and Aram's two younger brothers were included in that male admixture, alternately roughhousing with the other boys and being snatched upright by their father and made to stand still while they were dressed in their best. The Lockheed Martin Hellfire was an air-to-surface missile developed for precision strikes against individuals. The missile was developed under the name Helicopter-Launched Fire and Forget Missile, which led to the acronym Hellfire, that became the missile's formal name. The thermobaric weapon was a type of explosive that utilized oxygen from the surrounding air to generate an intense high-temperature explosion. In practice, its blast wave was significantly longer in duration than a conventional condensed explosive, the better to kill you with. And it was the last thing on Earth the wedding party imagined would be introduced into their dwelling. The missile entered the bedroom two doors down from Sevi and Aram, instantly killing all 13 occupants, four adult women, four girls under the age of 12, and five early teen girls. Continuing through the ceiling to the first floor, the missile exploded and sucked all oxygen out of the house and ignited lungs with flame that killed everyone, except Sevi al-Assad. She was located furthest from the blast and was blown out of the second floor bedroom as the wall fell away. Then the house caved in on itself, marking the scene as a spent funeral pyre. No cries were heard. No moans of pain, no tortured breathing. Spread-eagled across the bed of a Toyota pickup truck where she had come to rest was Sevi, 24 years old. She lay unconscious, which was, in a desperate way, fortuitous, because her back was broken, her left eardrum gone, and her left kneecap torn loose and lying on her thigh. Had she been conscious, she likely would have died from shock. Sirens sounded across the city of Deir Zor. Pedestrians stopped in their tracks as their eyes searched the skies for the predator responsible for the thick black smoke on the eastern end of the city. Many would be dead. The TV would broadcast accounts that night, and another unfathomable tragedy would fashion a new population of West haters. Before the EMTs arrived, a next-door neighbor discovered Sevi and stood watch over her broken body, discouraging those who would otherwise try to move her. "Wait," he told them. "She is injured, and we don't know how badly. We'll wait for the EMTs." When the EMTs came, Sevi was expertly manipulated on a backboard and strapped in place for hospital transport. At the hospital, it was determined she was alive, but just barely. 2. Blackguard was ruthless in its pursuit of oil. Sevi's brother, Arum al-Assad, had died because of his plan to sell crude oil to the Chinese instead of the Americans. Blackguard had come into this information through the use of paid informants. Blackguard belonged to the Dumont brothers, American oilmen who, in the end, believed all oil beneath the earth belonged to them. It was all part of a much larger picture for the Dumont brothers. They thought themselves patriots. They believed in the drastic reduction of corporate income taxes, the dramatic defunding of services for the needy, and they opposed climate change activists on all fronts. Their names were Wilfred and Edlin Dumont, and they had inherited a $200 billion fortune from their wildcatter father, who was said to have drained off 1 trillion barrels of Texas crude
for his 5,000 service stations across North America. The brothers were Massachusetts-born and bred. They had graduated from Harvard Law 2 years apart and were 3 years apart in age. Both had degrees from Yale in economics, and both envisioned a return to the days before the EPA was formed, with its regulations and restraints on drilling. They longed for the time when business had unfettered access to petroleum and coal reserves, and the clear-cutting of forests made good economic sense. Wilfred was born in 1935 and Edland in 1933. They were too young to serve in World War II in Korea and sat out the Vietnam War thanks to draft deferments handed out by John Kennedy, not only to the unwashed, but to libertarian elitists like the brothers. The whole Vietnam fiasco offended the brothers' economic sensibilities. So they contributed $20 million to Richard M. Nixon's campaign. It was thought a President Nixon would immediately withdraw America's military. Vietnam possessed no oil. Rice and bananas were the chief exports, so why make war there? The wars of the Middle East were another matter altogether. Those wars were about oil, and oil was to America what coal was to electricity. In 2009, when ISIS was struggling to arm its soldiers and feed the citizens of seized cities, the brothers boldly stepped forward. In return for Russian Kalashnikov AK-47 rifles, the leaders of ISIS entered into secret leases of Iraqi oil fields with the brothers. The leases would take hold and the oil would begin flowing to Dumont oil tankers when the Syrian president was deposed and the flag of ISIS flew over the Syrian desert. Arum al-Assad had gone back on the deal with his plan to sell Syrian oil to China. He died for that. While these machinations were cloaked in secrecy, they didn't escape the notice of America's Fifth Estate in the person of one Althea Berenson, a freelancing journalist. She had blown the lid off things with a series of reports on the link between a certain vice president during the Bush W. years and a certain business owned by the Dumonts that masqueraded as a construction company. That company operated on a massive scale, erecting the Baghdad Green Zone in 60 days following the American victory over Saddam Hussein. The feat required 40,000 carpenters, plumbers, electricians, and engineers. It was said to have airlifted 100 times the material delivered by Allied aircraft during the 1948 Berlin airlift. The Berlin job was primarily the work of the Dumont brothers' sire, Colonel Edmund Hillary Dumont. The Green Zone was primarily the work of Blackguard, the brothers' global construction, acquisition, and vigilante arm. When Althea Berenson discovered the link between the vice president and Blackguard, her newspaper series was nominated for a Pulitzer. But then, the vice president taught America what NFL running backs had long known: the virtues of misdirection. The VP's office exposed a CIA field agent, which obfuscated the appointment of a special prosecutor and the jailing of a minor talent among the VP's staff, a sentence later commuted by the president. During the brouhaha that followed the CIA agent outing, the VP made his getaway to Montana, retiring there in near seclusion while remaining quaintly quotable, his literary agent's words, when party politics required a hatchet job. But Althea Berenson wasn't finished with the story of the transfer of American treasure to Blackguard. Rather than let the story die when the VP retired, she reversed field and went after Blackguard itself. The public's eye followed. The war in Iraq earned Blackguard $500 billion. Blackguard vice presidents purchased island hideaways. Gulfstream jets were ordered by the hundreds. Fabulous parties were thrown that began in Miami Beach and ended when the sun came up in Tokyo. 1,000 Hollywoodites were feted in Vancouver over a weekend that included, in the swag baskets, a 3-carat diamond ring and a $5,000 marker for a posh Atlantic City casino. In the end, it was said the U.S. Mint had established a Baghdad printing facility. $100 bills flew off the press 24/7,
and truckloads of cash sallied forth to buy the allegiance of tribal heads and blackguard soldiers. It was, Althea found, money in the extreme. It was, Althea wrote, the greatest transfer of public monies to a private company in American history. Of the $500 billion in question, Althea further reported the Dumont brothers had secretly pocketed, loosely speaking, $100 billion for themselves. 10 years later, they were funding presidential campaigns to the tune of $100 million. So far, their hand-picked stooges had run unsuccessfully, but the brothers knew it was only a matter of time until they'd win. Before 2024, they expected to fund and thus own an American president. So Althea's reportage went. The only way to prevent this happening, she determined, was to break a story that revealed the brothers for what they were. Machiavellian puppeteers ready to recreate the United States as a libertarian plutocracy. In short, the 1% would progress from ruling the country economically to ruling it politically as well. America would become a true dictatorship controlled by two brothers with oil coursing through their veins. Althea Berenson was black, 35, and remained hot on the trail of blackguard scent. Althea wore a size 6 and was mocha-complected, like her friend Christine, but she wore her hair short, while Christine wore hers long. Althea was a mother of 4 and a 2-time bride, who was enjoying singularity now that the kids could babysit themselves and ex-husbands could be prevailed upon for weekend fathering. This new order freed up the journalist for her travels and restored her strength for her travails as she published widely and as she appeared on HBO's Real Time with Bill Maher. Her public persona was forever argumentative and confrontational, while her private persona was gentle and loving, especially with her children and her men. The kids were a given. The men came and went. Friendships abounded among Chicago's greater and lesser lights. Althea worked South Side food drives as capably and gracefully as she worked North Shore charity auctions. During the social mix, she became friends with Christine Sussman, the attorney defending the husband of Althea's college roommate on 2 counts of income tax evasion. A coffee was held to raise legal fees for the husband's defense fund. At the last minute, Christine Sussman attended and proclaimed the coffee unnecessary, as she was going to offer a free defense, which she did. The husband served 9 months in the same federal lockup where Martha Stewart had cleaned washrooms for lying to the FBI. That alone was enough for the husband to claim victory. Althea and Christine began meeting for Wednesday lunch. A few months later, Winona Lindsay joined them. She was a Chicago police detective who had jumped ship and now worked as a full-time investigator for Christine's law firm. Where Althea was compact and cherubic around the face, Winona was tall, muscular, and capable of taking out a kneecap with a leg sweep. Her naturally blonde hair was often worn, pulled back in a ponytail, and at night when Winona was on the town, it would be worn down and brushed to a luster. Where Althea was an intrepid researcher and Winona was a fearless detective, Christine was both weightlifter and firearms expert who swore allegiance to the rule of law. But even while confirming her respect for the law, Christine would slam home a .40 caliber magazine. And of course, Christine was a lawyer's lawyer. Beginning as a JAG paralegal during her Army days, and then working as a paralegal for Thaddeus Murphy, Christine had come into her own after suing the president of Russia and paying for law school with his dollars. Today they were meeting in Rinaldo's Bistro, an upscale Michigan Avenue eatery in Chicago on the North Loop. Rinaldo's was frequented by members of the local bar bent on keeping a low profile in a diner geographically removed from the Chicago legal system, which held court on the South Loop. Althea arrived first, grabbed a table for 4, and was systematically reviewing the menu a line at a time. So far, nothing had struck her fancy. A white Russian found its way to her, and she took a mouthful and tilted her head back,
allowing the chilled liquid to do its work on her alimentary canal while sparking her taste buds like Christmas tree lights. She was, in a word, happy with the world. White Russians and crowded menus did that to her, yet never moved the needle on the size 6 ensembles. Next came Christine, straight from court, where she had spent the morning arguing against a motion for summary judgment filed by the City of Chicago's attorneys in a case involving a highway lane drop and a claim of negligent signage in a construction zone. Her client had been made a quadriplegic when a 7-foot drainage pipe abruptly halted his 50-mile-per-hour Taurus. "How are tricks, Chris?" Althea asked with another swallow of her drink.
"Starting early, Althea?" said Christine, referring to the alcoholic drink.
"Never quit, so there's no early," Althea quipped.
"I hear that. Tricks are good. I'm suing all the right people and defending all the wrongly accused."
"And the kids?"
"Jamie is thriving. He's in advanced everything, his junior year. Janie is growing too fast and giving her third piano recital Saturday afternoon. Life is good."
"Men?"
"No, still missing Sonny," said Christine, referring to her deceased husband who had been murdered by a hitman who was actually after Christine.
"That's too bad, but I understand, definitely." At that point, Winona Lindsay joined the two women. She wore a translucent skim of makeup like some Vogue goddess. She was beyond attractive, even in middle age, and turned heads as she passed through the restaurant.
"Hey, Toots," said Christine to Winona. "Glad you could make it."
Winona did a fake shudder. "Terrible case. Made me ill to hear about it."
"Like what?" asked Christine.
"Well, we got an email from some woman in Syria. An American missile wiped out her entire family. Girls, boys, brothers, parents, aunts, and uncles. All buried under 20 feet of rubble."
"Sounds grisly," said Althea. "My guess is the Dumont brothers had something to do with it."
"Why would you say that?" asked Winona.
"I would say that because nothing horrible happens in the Middle East without Dumont's fingerprints all over."
"Why did she email us?" asked Christine.
Winona nodded. "She found our website. She liked what she read about you."
"And she's looking to us for what?"
"Something about suing the government."
"For what?" asked Althea. "Murder?"
"It was a drone strike. The only government I know of still killing off people with drones is the U.S. Stands to reason it was us."
Althea shuddered and took another sip of her drink.
"Dumont's. Screw them."
The waiter materialized and took drink orders from Christine and Winona, who ordered coffee and iced tea, respectively.
"Seriously," said Christine to Althea, "what makes you connect the Dumont's to this particular drone strike?"
Althea shrugged. "Their next stop is Syria. There are 10 trillion barrels of sweet crude under Syrian sand. How could they not be involved in removing obstacles in the way of Dumont oil tankers?"
"Gives me pause," said Christine. "We'll need to follow up on that," Christine said to Winona. "Let's see where it goes."
"Hey, you're talking to the wrong lady there," said Althea. "How about hiring me to investigate? It's only one more rock on a huge pile I already have stacked up against the Dumont's. With me having 99% of the research already done on my laptop, I can get back to you on it inside of 30 days.
"Interesting," said Christine. "How are your resources?"
"Intact. I've got people everywhere in the Middle East."
"CIA?"
"Some. Some Mossad. Some Iraqi. Some even Syrian Army."
"You need it? I've got it."
"Why, are you thinking about suing for this lady?"
"I'm thinking we should give it a hard look," said Christine. "I'm thinking I definitely want to follow up with her.
What's her name, Wen?"
"Sevi. Her name is Sevi al-Assad, and the wedding party was in Deir Zor, which is eastern Syria to you."
Christine nodded and spoke thoughtfully. "Sevi. Sevi al-Assad versus Blackguard Inc. Defendant. And United States of America. Defendant. Has a good ring to it. It does, agreed Winona. I told her we were interested.
You did? Without talking to me?
You said when I came over from the PD that I would work independently. Well, this is an exercise of my independence.
Got me there, said Christine. I wasn't challenging you. Or maybe I was. Sorry about that.
Forget it. This case has legs. A huge upside.
How many people died in the drone strike?
Get ready. She said 42 lost their lives.
OMG, said Althea. I'm definitely in.
Yes, so am I, said Christine. When can I talk to her?
I told her you'd come to Turkey next week. That too soon?
Depends on my calendar.
Covered. I moved some staff around so you could take the Gulf Stream to Turkey.
We're serious today, aren't we?
Winona smiled and accepted her iced tea from the waiter.
That's what you hired me for. Just doing my job, boss.
And rocking my world, said Christine.
So what about me? Asked Althea. Am I on board?
You are, said Christine. I want a smoking gun linking the Dumonts to the drone attack. Plain and simple.
I can do that, said Althea. It'll be the best money you spend this year.
What, you're charging me for this?
Althea smiled. You're lucky to get me. I'm worth every penny.
You are, girl, said Christine. Definitely that.
3.
5 months passed. Microsurgery repaired the fractured spine. The knee was reconstructed. 4 surgeries later, and Sevi began physical therapy. It was at first thought she wouldn't walk again, but in her determination, she managed to develop a limping gait. Hearing loss was at 100% and 50%. She was fitted with a hearing device and managed to again converse. All her family was gone. Her father and mother, brothers, aunts, uncles, and in-laws-to-be were lost in the destruction leveled at them by the Americans. The fiancé she planned to build her life with would never become the husband she had dreamed of so often. She missed her people and cried dozens of times a day. She saw no reason to recover and live on, but her therapists demanded she start her life all over. She returned to her home in a small village outside Deir Zor and eventually found a job as an internet-based computer programmer. Her undergraduate degree was in computer science, and she had most of a master's done in software engineering through an online school in California. While her body had been restored, her emotional state was anger from one end to the other. She hated Americans, hated America, and hated everything Western. She came to understand that her oldest brother had been the target that wedding day, and the rest of those present were merely collateral damage in the Americans' quest for high-value targets. With every day that passed, she loathed the West for its dispassionate genocide. She yearned to hit back, to destroy something, anything, and so displace her pain outside herself. At night, she studied maps and articles about America. She wondered how one might smuggle a bomb there. Anywhere inside the country would do, and avenge her family's death. She imagined herself as a suicide bomber for ISIS and carrying forward her brother's work. One night, as she scanned the internet and sought her revenge, she came upon a website. It was the website of an American lawyer, a woman who claimed she practiced public policy law. In a flash, Sevi recognized what needed to be done. She sent an email to the woman's website. In it, she asked, "Would you sue the U.S. government for the death of my family?" The woman's staff immediately wrote back and the conversation began. They wanted to talk. They wondered if Sevi could get to Ankara, Turkey. Sevi had never in her life considered traveling to Turkey, but she began to study the route and began to realize how that might be done. For if she made it there, the American lawyer would come to Turkey and they would talk. She wrote back and said she would find a way to meet the lawyer in Turkey. Then she studied the woman's internet page.
Her name was Christine Sussman.
"Well, Christine," said Sevi to the night sky, "while you are busy making the lawsuit, I will be busy making the bomb. Just get me to America."
With no other surviving heirs, her father's business ventures defaulted to Sevi. This included the plant that manufactured tires. Having inherited from her father the adaptive business gene as well, she put the tire enterprise up for sale.
After outstanding balances and tax owed to the governorate, she netted 2,833,931 SYP,
about 15,000 USD. She gave away her TV, refrigerator, and computer to the family living in the flat directly below her. Relieved of all worldly goods, she purchased a seat on a train that took her to the Syrian border with Turkey. At the border, she then walked to the bus station with her backpack and traveled into Turkey. It was a long, crowded, dusty ride that provided only intermittent times of relief from the overcrowding whenever the driver managed to kick the AC unit with the proper force, causing it to roar to life and circulate air back down the aisle to where Sevi sat reclined, a damp handkerchief over her face as she tried to find a moment alone.
Then she was in Ankara, where she checked into a hotel.
Now, to notify the American lawyer she was waiting. Then it would begin.
4.
Christine located her window seat on the Turkish Airlines Boeing B777-3. It was a wide-bodied plane with ample legroom and a seat 3 inches wider than business class. She buckled in and stared out the plexiglass. Her reflection stared back. Thick black hair parted severely down the middle and jaw length on the sides. Chocolate eyes gleaming with anticipation. Eyes that interpreted her world carefully and courageously. A thin but attractively flat nose with a white scar across the bridge from a training accident suffered in the Army's SEER school in Fort Bragg. And a firm mouth capable of holding its own in any dispute. She liked her face, and knowing she was totally alone, she winked at her reflection. It was childish and a bit coquettish, but it balanced out all the serious in her life. Stowed in the overhead was her backpack. It was her only piece of luggage. The topmost pocket contained her iPhone and mini iPad, both of which had been carefully scrubbed of all IP addresses that would indicate she was American, then loaded with browser bookmarks and histories that proved she was Pakistani. An unopened juice bottle of Pakistani origin lay secured in the water loop on the other side of the pack. Inside the large zipper on the front of the bag were Pakistani cigarettes and blue jeans and colored T-shirts, as well as American Teva sandals with an Amazon purchase receipt stored on the iPad's memory chip, which showed a conversion of currency from Pakistani rupees to American dollars. And down below, in the lower pocket, she had carefully stowed her passport and driver's license, also Pakistani, both several years old, both carefully forged at a cost of $12,500. Everything she carried and all traces and electronic bytes proved, and more importantly, didn't disprove, her claim of Pakistani citizenship. She flew Turkish Airlines from Chicago to Istanbul with a 4-hour layover in Berlin. A change of planes allowed on board a dark man. When first stepping inside the aircraft, his quarry was immediately picked out from the 300 faces aboard the 777 in a quick glance down the aisle. He had received a half dozen photographs to memorize, and he had been a careful student. He took his seat directly behind hers. He carefully avoided looking at her. They landed at 7:15 p.m. Istanbul time, jarring her awake from a light, restless sleep. She stood in her row and waited for it to clear, then reached up and found her backpack in the overhead. She swung the backpack out and down and worked the straps over her shoulders. She hadn't changed out of her sweatshirt, though she thought the outside temperature would be stifling and that she would need to shed the sweatshirt before leaving the terminal. The dark, seemingly oblivious man behind her timed his own standing and gathering of his backpack so he would be able to slip in behind her and follow her from the plane. He was shiny and dark, a Baghdad native and a Muslim. A hex wrench-shaped scar traveled from his right eyebrow straight back for an inch, then down his cheek for 3 inches. The suture line was pink against his skin, and fresh and angry. Tortoiseshell eyeglasses were perched atop his head. He fingered them absently once the backpack was in place. He was dressed in black khaki pants and a black polo shirt. He appeared almost careless as he tinkered with his pack and glasses. More than anything, he was patient. As Christine fought to shrug into her backpack straps over the bulky sweatshirt, the dark man leaned back against his seat and allowed two travelers to pass by and join the line standing in the aisle. He pretended to be busy with his own pack, but actually was not. He was simply waiting for Christine. When he had boarded her flight in Berlin, he brought with him her flight particulars courtesy of the hacked Turkish airline reservation system. He knew her only as Ama Glock. That was the name given to him. Not much of a challenge, he thought of her stature, as he sized her up. The rest of it promised to be simple for an inveterate plant like him. The Iraqi followed her up the jetway and into the terminal. There she found a light-skinned woman wearing a headscarf and holding a simple, hand-lettered sign that said, Ama. Christine approached the woman and identified herself. I'm Ama Glock. Say it. When it rains, it pours. When it's raining, it's pouring. Christine nodded and accepted the straw-colored bag the woman held out to her. Without another word, they parted. Christine headed for the restroom. She found an empty booth and opened the bag. Perfect. Glock 19 with IWB in waistband, holster, and extra clip for the belt. She shrugged out of the backpack, pulled up the sweatshirt, worked it over her head, and stuffed it into the large pocket. She pulled at the waistband of her blue jeans and inserted the holstered gun inside on the right. The extra clip snapped over her 2-inch wide black belt. She pulled her white t-shirt hem down over the holster. The t-shirt was 2 sizes too big and hid the print of the IWB carry. Quickly, she finger-brushed her hair back on both sides and stood upright. Everything fit. The gun felt familiar, so she unlocked the stall and stepped out. She managed 1 step before a forearm came smashing around the corner of the stall and caught her directly in the throat. She was thrown back, staggered, gasping for air, and raising her hands defensively as her Taekwondo reflex took over. A woman followed the forearm and stepped directly in front of Christine, pointing a small revolver in a 2-handed grip. Christine appeared to faint, and as she dropped, she swept her right leg against the woman's shin, dropping her to the tile floor. As the woman fell, Christine rolled into her, seizing the pistol and slamming it hard against the woman's nose. Blood spurted from the gaping wound, and Ama knew the woman's own tears would momentarily blind her, giving Ama, at best, 3 seconds to end it. She raised up to her knees and struck again, this time with the butt of the pistol, fracturing the skull. Instantly, the woman's eyes fluttered and closed, and she limply sprawled across the tile. Christine stood and wiped the gun quickly. Then she dropped it on the floor and stepped over her assailant, exiting the restroom while assuming the relaxed face of a passenger who just woke up and stepped off a long flight. She didn't notice the dark man standing across the passageway, outside the men's restroom, studying a street map and moving his lips as if reading. Nor did she notice him toss aside the map and follow when she headed outside for the taxi stand. A 10-year-old Volvo cab was next in line. The driver motioned her to climb in. She pulled open the back door. Tossing her backpack across the seat, she stepped in and was lowering herself to the seat when she felt a hand push her shoulder. The dark man looked into her eyes and she raised her legs as if to kick at him, when he simply said, "When it rains, it pours." She froze, then lowered her feet to the floor of the cab. "You are?" "I am Swarmi Redis. I am your bodyguard." "You are early. You were to wait until I met the woman. I know. Move over, please.
Christine slid across the seat and the man sat down beside her.
Winona Lindsay sent me.
Show me your ID, please.
He smiled. Amma, I am not carrying ID any more than you are. The last thing we want here is ID.
How do I know you're who you say you are?
Respond, please, so I can be sure you are who I think you are.
She sat back hard against the seat and stared out her window for several seconds. The man had the passkey, the word quintet that proved authorization. She turned back around.
When it's raining, it's pouring, she said. Thank you, said the man named Radiz.
The cab driver raised his hands and shrugged and said in Arabic,
Where to?
Christine answered in Arabic, Pendik Station, please. The cabbie nodded and smiled. It was a welcome fare, as Pendik Station was 25 kilometers east of Istanbul. He wheeled the old Volvo into the moving traffic lane and beamed in the rear view.
Please, relax and enjoy.
We'll talk at the station, said Radiz to Christine,
with a nod at the driver.
Ears.
Christine stared out the window to her left. Istanbul was a modern city. The freeway was smooth and freshly topped, and the evening air not nearly as hot as she had expected. In fact, it was even pleasant. She cracked her window and inhaled. The air was pure and clean, with a hint of plowed earth and new plants pushing through the soil of the fields that were opening up as they left the city behind. Ahead of them was an 18-wheeler with the omnipresent mud flaps of the nude woman in silver silhouette, and for a brief instant she imagined she was back in Chicago, rolling eastbound on the Kennedy, headed for the office. She thought of Sonny, her husband of 10 years, now deceased, and her two children, Jamie and Janny, probably huddled around the TV since Christine was away and their nanny was known to snooze. A pang of regret pierced her. What in God's name had she been thinking, taking on this assignment? Had she totally lost her mind? She gasped at the cool air, but then caught herself and forced her mind to empty itself of thoughts of home and family and focus instead on the now, where she was traveling 90 kilometers per hour on the outskirts of Istanbul next to a man whom she'd neither expected nor trusted, but who seemed to know her. Her mind raced off in a new direction, and again she forced calm down through her body and up into her brain. It was partly from her military training, the SEER school at Fort Bragg, where she had learned survival, evasion, resistance, and escape. It was her innate ability since birth to control her thoughts and feelings and steady herself even in moments of danger. At last she smiled and stared ahead through the windshield. Suddenly, she was all in. No regrets, no looking back. Let's get underway and see about suing Uncle. The last 10 kilometers were a blur. She could almost feel the luxury of the overstuffed seats on the high-speed train to Ankara. The man sitting next to her was silent. Was he her bodyguard? If so, he was early to the game. Or was he a plant? But who would know about her mission? She knew the answer to that, of course. The NSA monitored all communications between Americans and foreigners. She had no doubt they knew she was meeting with the Syrian woman. She had no doubt they knew the topic of the meeting. She glanced sideways at the man. She wondered if he knew about the meeting, too, and had come to protect the government. Or was he simply there as her protection? She wondered if he knew he might breathe his last in the next 15 minutes. She just hadn't decided. 5. Sevi was waiting in Ankara for the meeting with Christine. She was at once both excited and sad as she considered taking her revenge against the Americans. Excited because her time had finally come around. Sad because of her loss. She was lying on the made bed, a four-poster, when the alarm on her iPhone beeped. It was almost time. She rolled upright on the bed and crossed to the window of the JW Marriott Hotel. The room was richly constructed with wainscoting all around.
Mirrors festooned all six walls and reflected the indirect and direct lighting that had been expertly installed, so that the mirrors all represented eye-catching points of light. Expensive, soft bedclothes and a luxurious bathroom with recessed lighting and whirlpool tub enhanced the ambiance. Room service that would bring any food from its five-star restaurant in under 30 minutes, no matter the food, country represented, or difficulty in preparation, was an almost unimaginable benefit. The room had been reserved by the American lawyer's office and impressed Sevi no end. Earlier that evening, she had been reflecting on the things she would say to the lawyer and the things she wouldn't say. There were much more of the latter than the former. For example, she wouldn't mention that ISIS activists in a camp near her home had schooled her in the gathering of materials for making a bomb. She also wouldn't mention that she knew the chemistry and physics of plastic explosives, or that she knew the mechanics and electronics of timing devices and detonation plugs. The schooling had been quick, and she had been a most willing student, as she allowed her mind to consider revenge and the bombing of an American grade school in payback for all the young people murdered on her own wedding day. Among the dead were over 25 children, all related to her, or who soon would have been by marriage. The 25 were all under the age of 14 and were total innocents in the struggles among oil-seeking nations in the Middle East. They had been children who knew only that there was going to be a wonderful party after the mandatory wedding ceremony. Crossing to the window and its drawn curtains, she was wearing the comfortable Turkish bloomers called ayalvar, a top with sleeves to the elbows and a headscarf, as she would be venturing downstairs to the hotel restaurant, and one always wore the headscarf in public. She passed her hand through the curtain closure seam and peered out at the traffic below. In the distance, she could make out the buildings on the campus of Bilkent University, and a mile or two closer, the low profile of the campus of Hacettepe University. She knew these things because she had been encamped in the hotel for 2 days and had purchased a guidebook in the hotel gift shop as a way of passing time. Almost at her feet below was the Armada Shopping Center, where she had spent a long, leisurely afternoon window shopping and tasting coffees from America at the bazaar there. She had with her the clothes on her back and a small suitcase containing all her other worldly goods remaining after what she called the great sell-off. She had transformed her world from one of property ownership to one of a small sum of money in the Bank of America and a willingness to travel lightly to America where she would start over. The lawyer would be arriving at Ankara ESB Asemwa Airport any moment and would settle into the room next to Sevi's, all reservations obtained and paid for by the lawyer. Sevi watched the traffic below as it crawled along the boulevard. At a level with the 30th floor room, and in the distance, a continuous stream of winking aircraft lights passed from left to right as incoming flights arrived and disgorged their customers in Turkey's capital city on this particular Friday night. She considered her temporary circumstances. She knew that Turkey was bordered by 8 countries, Bulgaria to the northwest, Greece to the west, Georgia to the northeast, Armenia, Iran, and the Azerbaijani exclave of Nakhchivan to the east, and Iraq and Syria to the south. On the other side of the hotel from where she stood, the Mediterranean Sea was to the south, the Aegean Sea to the west, and the Black Sea to the north. Her guidebook, while instructive enough, had been carelessly deposited in the bathroom waste paper bin that afternoon. It was a final gesture by Sevi, a way of saying goodbye to the Middle East, and she was anxious to strike out for the West, anxious to learn about her new home. She was bravely resigned to the fact that she would be totally starting over there. None of what she knew would matter anymore. Life as she had known it was over and done. For her, a new day was coming. She withdrew her hand from the curtains, allowing them to reseal along the seam, and went to the marble desk with its gold telephone and array of in-hotel buttons that could be pressed and instantly summon everything from food to facials,
from massages to flowers.
It was nearing the time for her meeting with Christine, so she reconsidered going downstairs to eat.
She selected the room service line and lifted the phone.
"I would like American food," she told the attendant. "What do you recommend?"
"We have beefsteak dinners, chicken, and fish."
"Something with fish."
"May I suggest our sautéed salmon? It comes with spring potatoes and steamed vegetables, and perhaps a cocktail or wine."
"That would be fine, but no alcohol. American coffee instead."
"American dining at your service. We will be at your door in 30 minutes or less. Always our promise to you at the JW Marriott, Ankara."
"Thank you."
She sat back in the desk chair and considered herself in the mirror. She was young-looking despite the horrors of the last year, but still moved with a limp, had difficulty with conversations, and couldn't hear at all without her behind-the-ear hearing aid worn hidden beneath her long hair. They had left her quite a mess, the Americans. She was always in pain somewhere in her body, especially along the spine, where she had suffered massive trauma. Sleep was difficult and restless, and she doubted she would ever be able to receive a man in the missionary position. But that was beside the point. She had lost the only man she would ever consider marrying, and there would be no looking for another to replace him. That part of her life, the romance of youth, had been amputated away from her psyche as carefully as the damaged bone and cartilage of her physical injuries had been removed. No, she was alone, and she had come to be satisfied with that. Not happy, certainly, but satisfied. And though there was a major difference between the two, it was a difference she had learned to live with. The Americans had taught her that. Now it was their turn. She would teach them what that loss felt like. Then, maybe in the future, they would be less careless with their missiles. Her explosive device and the message it would send would save Syrian lives. Maybe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.